hear the tires squeal. Red light can't stop, so I spin the wheel. My world goes black before I feel an angel lift me up, and I open bloodshot eyes into fluorescent white. I flip the siren, hit the lights, close the doors, and I am gone.
Friday afternoon, and I rolled into our parking lot, and per our usual routine, I went to the back door and called her from the parking lot and said, I'm coming to the back door, please let me in. So I went to the back door and waited for a moment for her, and she didn't respond. And so I picked up the phone again, calling her, say, hey, you know, seriously, I'm at the back door. And she didn't answer the phone.
I remember waking up at some point and walking through the living room. He says he followed me into the back, or through our back door, through our back lanai, to our living room, and I'm talking gibberish.
I knew that I had to call 911, and I went and grabbed the house phone and called 911 right away.
Call came in for a possible stroke, responded to the call. We arrived on scene about the same time as fire got to patient.
En route to the call, I started thinking of my assessments and fast G's and what we're going to do for her once we get there. And when we arrived on scene, we found her, I believe she was on the ground. She was somewhat confused. I believe we did start the process as far as the fast G, but we weren't able to complete it. And she began to seize at that point.
We were attempting to start an IV and were unable to due to the patient's massive seizure.
On the way home from work, that was the day that Mitch had actually called my in-laws and said, I'm going to finally do it. I'm going to ask Denise to marry me. And it's a big deal because we'd been together 6 years at that point. And that was January 25th of this year. And then he came home to find me having those seizures.
What we do for them don't only affect them, but it affects their family. And it affects a lot of people around them. And that kind of helps us to gain perspective of why we're doing what we're doing and who we're doing it for.
Sometimes we take it granted for what we do with people's lives that we touch that we don't realize that we touch.
Every time I respond to a call, I think of the whole picture, and not only just what I'm doing, but I want to help that patient, their family, and whoever else.
What do you say to the people that answer that true calling of being an asset to their community in a way that not many people can be? I mean, what do you say to those people that selfishly and selflessly show up at your home and save your life, and they don't know you and they don't know anything about you, and they just, you pick up the phone and they're there?
These people rescued my future.
Our conversation with Ireland was that you're hurt, but we're going to take very good care of you. We explained everything that we're doing to her, and even though she was so little, she nodded as if she understood us. That's what really kind of broke our heart, seeing her in such terrible condition.
Once he went out to mow the lawn, she wouldn't stop with wanting to be by him. As soon as that lawnmower stopped, it was like, all right, I knew we needed ice, we needed towels, and I needed to call 911.
The last thing I really, truly remember vividly was when Allie, our next door neighbor, went to take her from me, and I saw that she was, you know, awake, and when I released her legs, because I had them under my arm trying to keep pressure, and I didn't see any blood, and then my mind just went, I don't know where it went.
When we pulled on scene, we heard fire call, trauma alert, air upgrade. So we're thinking, okay, we gotta get some things. So I go to grab a board off the back of the truck while he's pulling the stretcher out. And that's when I look up on the lawn and see them working on a little kid.
As we pulled up, it was called Bayflight, and we looked at each other, and then we knew it was gonna be serious.
First thing that went through my mind was it was kind of like any other call, and it's like, oh great, they're freaking out over nothing. Getting on scene, I mean, there was a lot of blood, fire was down, there was a firefighter on each side of the patient already working on her leg wounds.
At that point, I didn't know what happened, like if she had fallen off the lawnmower from his lap, if she had, you know, was out in the yard and he accidentally hit her and didn't see her. We didn't know.
One of the fire crews asked her could she smile, and she said no, or she shook her head saying no. So the other one said, well, can you stick your tongue out? Which she did. She stuck her tongue out, we all laughed, and she kind of gave a little bit of a grin.
You know, I had this sense that everybody was working as hard as they could, and knowing that she was going to be Bayflighted was, for me, a little scary, but I knew that that's what needed to happen. She needed to get there as fast as she could.
I remember telling her, we're going to give you some medicine that's going to make you really sleepy, but I promise you we're going to take very good care of you. I was like, okay, and she nodded her head saying yes.
At that point, the flight crew jumped in and got her intubated and ready and transferred over to their stretcher.
Being that I was right at her head, I was holding her hand. And as we got out of the truck and, you know, all the way to their stretcher, I just held her hand and we transferred her over. And I mean, at this time she was already out, intubated. But walking away from it, you kind of feel helpless. It's like, you know, they're even more so, more trained than we are. So she's in good hands. She's on the way to the best facility for her injuries. And it was, I think that's the feeling of helplessness after that is kind of what gets you as we're cleaning up the back of our rig.
Megan came and she told me that we were going to be pulled. And then I knew that, you know, I could sit down and really let it sink in. And it's just, once you start thinking about it, you know, all you want to do is see your own family. You want to see the ones you love and be thankful for what you have.
They shared in my pain. I know that sounds weird, but that this wasn't just another call to them, because this was such a big integral piece of our lives and such a game changer for Ireland, that this wasn't just another call to Sunstar.
Me and my wife, we wrote thank you cards and sent out to everybody in upper management who was involved, because they gave us time off to be together. Paid time off. I mean, it's not a normal thing that happens, you know, at a job, but they were there for us when we needed it the most.
You have the greatest opportunity to change people's lives. Give some people a second chance. Give some people a chance to talk to their relative again. That's one of the biggest rewards we have in this job.
And maybe you'll be lucky enough never to have that traumatic call, but if you do, maybe you'll be lucky as we are and get to see the amazing change that you made in somebody else's life.
You are one of the reasons that she's here today, and you held her hand and you told her it was going to be okay when she was experiencing terror and her body was probably in such shock. You are that family's hero.
I still don't consider myself a hero. I was doing my job. I'm very passionate about my job. I love doing what I do, and you know, knowing that I was able to help her, it just makes me love my job that much more.
Feeling my way through the darkness, guided by a beating heart. I can't tell where the journey will end, but I know where to start. They tell me I'm too young to understand. They say I'm caught up in a dream. Well, life will pass me by if I don't open up my eyes. So that's fine by me. So wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I didn't know I was lost. So wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I. That I could stay forever this young, not afraid to close my eyes. Life's a game made for everyone, and love is the prize. So wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I. So wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I didn't know I was lost. I didn't know I was lost.
I was awoken by calls and text messages from an ex-boyfriend, and it was around 2 o'clock in the morning. I was sound asleep, and I had school the next morning at 8. So I answered, wanting to know what he wanted, and he begged just to see me one last time. The moment I walked outside, he wrapped his arms around me for a hug, and he was hiding a switchblade in his hand. And he first stabbed me here in the back of the shoulder, then the back of the neck, and then the side of my face. And those are the only three that I remember, but there was 29 more after that. He left me laying there in the road and drove away quietly, and I was the only one, and I knew that I was gonna die there. Actually, two teenagers saved me. A girl called 911 and her boyfriend pulled him off me, and that's the only reason that first responders came.
Jason and I were dispatched for a female that was stabbed. Unknown situation, unknown staging.
She was laying on the side of the road. I mean, she was filthy. She had just been through the fight of her life, literally. I wouldn't imagine that she could be alive the way that she was laying in the road, face down, covered in blood.
She reached her hand up and said, "Save me, I don't want to die."
At that time, we got Melissa onto the backboard and we declared a trauma alert, and we needed an air upgrade.
They rolled me over, was looking at me, and put me on the backboard, and I remember I was able to tell them who I was, and they asked me who did this, and I told them. When I was laying there, I knew I was not gonna make it, and I wasn't able to scream anymore or anything when I was alone. And as soon as they all got there is when I felt that relief that they were gonna be the ones to save me.
I just kept talking to her and making her open her eye the best she could, the one that was opposite of the stab. And just telling her to stay with me, just keep opening her eyes and just stay with me, keep breathing, that we're there to help her, that we're gonna save her.
There were a few points where I remember her saying, you know, am I gonna die, am I gonna die? You know, don't let me die. And really the best thing I could say at the time was, we're doing everything we can.
I was just there and I felt myself dying. That's when I began to pray for my mom, and I prayed that I didn't want her to walk out here to my murder. I was worked on by tons, what I feel like was tons of people, but I think it was like four. But it felt like everyone was all over me at once and doing everything that they could to truly save me.
There's so much mundane in this job, and then when something like this happens, it's so, oh my gosh, I love my job. You know, you'll never believe what happened at work today.
When you start this job, you have to be prepared to see the things that you don't always want to see. Is it hard to shake some of them? Yes. Some of them, are you glad you didn't shake? I'm very glad I didn't shake this call. I have a new friend.
There's no words to describe how it feels that truly that they are the reason I'm alive, and without them, I wouldn't be here. It's hard to put into words how to say thank you to someone who saved your life. But I'm forever grateful.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I should be sleeping like a log. But when I get home to you, I find the things that you do will make me feel just anybody. Help! You know I need someone. Help! When I was younger, so much younger than today, I never needed anybody's help in any way. But now these days are gone, and I'm not so self-assured. Now I find, I've changed my mind, I'll open up the doors. Help me get my feet back on the ground. Won't you please help me?
There's a chance that we might fall apart before too long. We can work it out. We can work it out. Can't buy me love. Love. Can't buy me love. I'll buy you a diamond ring, my friend, if it makes you feel alright. I'll get you anything, my friend, if it makes you feel alright. Cause I don't care too much for money, but money can buy me love. I'll give you all I've got to give if you say you love me too. I may not have a lot to give, but what I got, I'll give to you.
For a lifetime of service in the name of love, I wanna thank you. I could say it a thousand times and it wouldn't be enough. I wanna thank you for everything you do. I wrote a song about ya. What would we do without ya? And we won't forget. And all our lives have been blessed, cause you're simply the best. And we thank you. Appreciate it. For a lifetime of service in the name of love, I wanna thank you. I could say it a thousand times and it wouldn't be enough. I wanna thank you for everything you do. I wrote a song about ya. What would we do without ya? We won't forget. And all our lives have been blessed, cause you're simply the best. See ya.